Making it as a professional athlete is a dream of many, but some people don't realize everything that comes with it. Not only are these athletes putting their blood, sweat, and tears into everything they do, they're also making themselves a target just by being successful. With Rob Gronkowski being a monster who many people wouldn't mess with, while he and the Patriots were losing to the Eagles in the 2018 Super Bowl, his house was being run through. Foxborough Police Chief William Baker said, "I don't know if you've ever been the victim of a break-in, but when you're robbed and there's an intrusion in your personal space, it's unpleasant whether you're Rob Gronkowski or Bill Baker. For him, it's a double whammy coming off the loss." While the police declined to share what exactly was stolen, reports have confirmed that at least three of Rob's guns were stolen from the house. Rob had called 911 a day after returning home from the Super Bowl in Minnesota, telling the 911 operator, "Hello, this isn't an emergency. This is Rob Gronkowski calling, and while I was gone, my whole house got robbed while on the Super Bowl trip, and I just got back." The burglars had broken into his house around 8 p.m. on Super Bowl night. Three men had gotten past Rob's front gate and entered his residence by breaking a window. Police later identified the burglars as Shane Den, Eric Tyrell, and Anthony Almeida. Tyrell would turn himself in not too long after the robbery. Almeida was arrested after his house was searched, and then remained a fugitive for 2 months. That was until he was picked up by police in Maine for driving without a license, providing a false name, and most notably being a fugitive. During those 2 months, Den had gone on a rampant crime spree, robbing a gas station, stealing a truck, and then running that truck into a business. While a judge was determining his bail, Den decided to attend his hearing wearing a t-shirt with the Patriots logo on it. The judge responded by declaring a bail of $100,000. With Ray Ray Armstrong and Reuben Foster being best friends and teammates, unfortunately, they were both in the wrong place at the wrong time and almost lost their lives. Good friends and fellow teammates on the San Francisco 49ers, Ray Ray Armstrong and Reuben Foster were robbed at gunpoint back in 2017. After they had returned from flying on a team trip from Washington, the two decided to go to a local San Francisco nightclub. Around 2 a.m., Foster noticed a white Audi with tinted windows circling the building. The car's movement was suspicious enough to have caused the friends to decide to leave the club. Foster, realizing what may happen after leaving the club, entrusted a female friend to take his watch and ring before he walked out, and Armstrong with a security guard. As they were being escorted to their vehicles, two masked men approached them on the sidewalk armed with an assault rifle and a handgun. The three immediately ran away and escaped to a local hotel where they called police. The robbers were not willing to chase them, and after seeing them run, they escaped and have not been identified nor apprehended since. Foster spoke to reporters following the incident, stating, "I'm blessed to be safe. I don't want to get into detail. I'm just happy me and Ray and the rest of the people are safe. It was a scary moment for my family and for the organization. I'm truly sorry to whomever was concerned and the organization itself and the fans that I concerned them. You live and you learn. Just watch your surroundings." Tom Brady was the victim of a robbery that had taken place right in his locker room after a Super Bowl 51 victory. Brady had taken off his game-worn jersey and gave it to a Patriot official who then ran it back over to the Patriots' locker room. He didn't realize it at the time, but it would be the last time he'd be seeing that jersey for some time. When the stadium was starting to empty out, Brady had gone into his locker room only to find his jersey missing. Security and stadium staff were tasked to find the jersey, but they found nothing, and it was assumed the culprit had likely put their jersey up for sale online. Brady spoke about the incident, stating, "It's unfortunate, because that's a nice piece of memorabilia. If it shows up on eBay or something, somebody let me know. I'll try to track that down. Those are pretty special ones to keep, but what can you do? I'll take the ring. That's good enough for me." It was later reported that a Mexican journalist who had gotten a press pass sneaked his way through all the chaos into the team's locker room and stole the jersey. A 1,000-mile investigation ensued in search for the man that was identified as Martin Mauricio Ortega. This was all thanks to Dylan Wagner. Dylan Wagner was a Boston-born Patriots fan, so much so he had even become a collector of specialty football items. Before the events had transpired, Wagner had sold a game-worn Deion Branch jersey on eBay. Wagner was interested in seeing the buyer's collection and requested photos of his collection. The buyer happily showcased his many jerseys in over 27 photos sent to Wagner. However, there was one of them that was placed front and center amongst the others, and that was a game-worn Brady jersey from that night. When Wagner asked how he gotten it, the buyer responded responded with, "I'll tell you later," and the two would never message again. The jersey had not been reported yet, so the only thing Wagner had done was send it over to his friends, one of which worked at the ATF. When the news story had broken out that Brady's jersey had been stolen, Wagner's friend sent him a contact who worked with the FBI. The agent was able to get enough information from Wagner to connect the photos and IP address to Ortega. After tipping off Mexican officials, police were sent out to Ortega's home in Mexico City, where the jersey was found, alongside a Denver Broncos helmet which belonged to Von Miller from Super Bowl 50, and a Brady Super Bowl 49 jersey that had come about in the raid. After his jerseys were returned, Brady released a statement, "I'm happy my jerseys from Super Bowl 49 and 51 have been recovered, and I want to thank all the law enforcement agencies involved. I know they worked hard on this case, and it's very much appreciated. Hopefully, when I get their jerseys back, I can make something very positive come from this experience." Had it not been for Wagner's tip, the raid would have likely never happened. Wagner was praised by Patriots owner Robert Kraft, who gifted Wagner a signed Brady football, signed Brady jersey, a pair of Kraft's Air Force Ones, and a pair of tickets to the next season NFL opener. The jersey Wagner had helped find was later appraised at $500,000. With Antonio Brown being the topic of lots of controversy lately, him showing off his expensive taste eventually came back to bite him. After coming back from an 11-day vacation, Antonio discovered that $80,000 that had been stored in a bag along with a firearm had been stolen. Brown had been living in the apartment by himself after separating with his girlfriend 2 weeks prior, and the police launched an investigation that had found surveillance video of a cleaning crew entering his apartment on April 13th. The cleaning crew were questioned by the police, however, they denied taking any belongings and suggested it may have been someone else that had entered during the 11 days he was out. Brown had placed the cash in a bag a day before leaving for his vacation, and by the time he returned, his apartment was clean, the laundry was done, but his money and gun were gone. Security logs obtained by police also found that an AC repairman had also come in, along with another woman who picked up a table from there. Police had the apartment checked for forensics, however, no reports had come from their findings. The next day, Brown had thrown a tantrum inside of his $35,000 a month apartment that resulted in him throwing his furniture out of his 14th floor balcony. To make matters worse, the furniture thrown had nearly hit a 22-month-old toddler. After discovering who had thrown the furniture, the parents of the child filed a lawsuit against Brown seeking damages for assault and intentional infliction of emotional distress. The lawsuit also alleges that Brown had acted without regard for human life and states the toddler suffers nightmares from the incident. Brown was not arrested for the furniture incident. However, the complex said they would evict him. And right when it couldn't get any worse, Brown had called police the next day about his Rolls Royce being stolen, but luckily he found it before cops had arrived. When the police did arrive at his apartment, he opened the door stating, "I found it," and slammed the door in their faces. We later came to find out that these series of incidents would be the least of his issues, concerning now he faces jail time for burglary and assault. Former Baltimore Ravens running back Terrence West filed a lawsuit against a hotel he stayed at in Miami for allowing two women and a man to rob him not once, but twice in a day during his stay. In late 2016, West had met two women with a friend at the Metropole Hotel. After the group had talked for some time, the group parted ways. Shortly after, the woman had gone to the hotel's front desk and asked for a set of keys to enter West's suite, and for reasons that have not been discovered, the desk clerk gave them the keys. With the keys to West's suite, the women entered and ran off with two Rolexes that were worth at least $50,000. When West returned to the suite and realized his watches were missing, he called police and filed a report. Some hours later, West received a knock on the door. Assuming it was police coming to do a follow-up, he opened it only to find it was another burglar. The man told West he would kill him and his friends if he didn't comply. West was never held at gunpoint, but assumed the man had a gun after seeing a bulge in his waistband. West decided to give the man what he wanted and handed over another $5,000 in cash and Louis Vuitton shoes. Following the robberies that had taken place, West blamed the hotel and the staff for allowing the women into his suite in the first place. Trying to seek compensation without the court system, West attempted to negotiate with the hotel, and when that failed, he sued the hotel along with the staff for $53,000 worth of damages. The lawsuit did reach a conclusion after both parties settled before going to trial. However, the details are confidential. His attorney would only comment that his client was happy with the results. With Sean Rogers being the target of a robbery while he was on vacation, his story shows why you shouldn't trust someone you just met. During his stay at a hotel, Rogers had gone to the popular nightclub Live, where he had met a woman. After a night out partying, he brought the woman back to the hotel, who spent the night with him. Before going to sleep that night, Rogers had put $500,000 worth of jewelry he had on that night in the safe. However, by the time he had woken up the next morning, both the woman and the jewelry were gone. Inside the safe was an assortment of gold bracelets, diamond earrings, gold necklaces, and watches, all of which the woman had taken off with. He never got the woman's name, but was able to provide a phone number to authorities, who launched a search for the woman. Police were eventually able to catch up with the woman a few months later, who was identified as 25-year-old Sabana Bia in Queens, New York. Police had looked for Bia since she had been a fugitive that had been wanted for multiple larcenies, where she would run off with jewelry and cash. The arrest followed officers in Miami to identify her with three other women who were known to target wealthy men in upscale bars and restaurants. They would go home with the men and then drug them in order to steal their money and jewelry. The connection was then made by police that she may have been the woman who stole from Rogers. After identifying her, she racked up additional larceny-related charges. With Le'Veon Bell making millions and spending millions as well, he learned the hard way about not leaving people in your house when you're gone. After spending a long night out and eventually coming back to his house, Bell had two girlfriends over for the night. He had gone to the gym the next morning, and by the time he had arrived back, the women were gone, and so was $520,000 worth of items from his home. Bell called 911 stating, "Well, I had two girls in my house, and I got up and I did my normal routine to go work out. So I left to work out for a couple of hours. When I came back, they took my money, they took my watch, my jewelry, a couple of more things of value out of my house. I don't know where they at. I tried to call them before I called you guys. I tried to call them and they're not answering me and they're ignoring me." Of the stolen items were two gold chains, a Black Panther pendant, and a Rolex watch. Luckily for Bell, the valuables were insured, and a few months later, TMZ reported that he had gone on a $300,000 shopping spree where he purchased multiple diamond rings and bracelets. With Earl Wolf being relatively new to the game of football, he went through one of the scariest things a person can go through when he was robbed. Earl Wolf had only been in his third year in the NFL when he was violently kidnapped and robbed in 2016. Wolf had been visiting his hometown, Fayetteville, North Carolina, to attend both his friend's and mother's birthdays. After leaving his friend's birthday party, Wolf headed to his car parked on the street. As he was putting on his seatbelt, a masked man armed with an AK-47 pointed the gun at him and demanded he get out of the car. As Wolf stepped out of the car, more armed men approached him as they asked for his wallet. The men forced Wolf into the back seat of his car, and the group began to drive around. After telling the men what his name was, one of the burglars recognized him as an NFL player. The men then drove to an ATM and had Wolf pull out $10,000. Wolf remembered that his financial advisor instructed him to not have a lot of money in his bank account. The advice would nearly cost him his life. The men doubted Wolf had only $400 in his account, but after logging into his bank from his phone, they believed him. Still hungry for more, the men drove back to his friend's house and showed up to the doorstep with Wolf at gunpoint. After opening the door for a brief moment, Wolf's friend slammed the door shut. The men started to panic, wondering if Wolf's friend would now call the police. They rushed Wolf back into the car and drove off again. After driving for a few minutes, the men threw Wolf out of the car and in the middle of a trailer park. Eventually, Wolf is able to make it to a gas station where a woman helped him call for police. Wolf sustained cuts and bruises, a small price to pay considering how bad the situation could have turned. After the events, Wolf talked about the experience in a first-person essay stating, "The investigation is still ongoing. At first, the police thought my friend had set me up, but that never crossed my mind. There's a chance someone might have had a petty beef with my friend, or the kidnappers may have been simply attracted to my car. I don't think I was targeted because I'm in the NFL. Wrong place, wrong time. It can happen to anyone."